hosted by Kirstie Alley. Join us for an evening with Tom Hanks, Davy Crockett, Michael Richards, George Foreman, Professor Ludwig Von Drake, Elton John, The Mickey Mouse Club, Priscilla Presley, and much more. All here tonight on ABC.
I'm Michael Eisner, head of the Walt Disney Company. Over the next 2 hours, we are going to enjoy some of the greatest moments in Disney television history. We'll see rare clips from Disney's first color broadcast, The Wonderful World of Color. We'll visit the original Mickey Mouse Club and relive the adventures of Davy Crockett. We'll go beyond the scenes of Disney television and see dazzling technical innovations and magical special effects. We'll listen to timeless Disney music and revisit some of our favorite Disney stars. And once again, we'll be reminded of the genius of Walt Disney. So if you're ready, let's go back to those simple days when television had only three channels, the picture was black and white, and Sunday night meant Disney.
Sorry I kept you waiting. I forgot my box of junk.
Wonderful World of Disney. 40 years of television magic. And now your host, Kirstie Alley.
Welcome to Disneyland. You know, when I was a little girl, I wanted to marry Walt Disney. Because then I could live in Disneyland and I could have it all to myself. Well, tonight I do. Between 1946 and 1964, the number of children in America doubled. As babies boomed, so did Disney on television. And for many of us, it made the growing pains a little easier. Sunday night was family night, remember? Finishing your homework, trying to get out of doing the dishes. It all had to be done by the stroke of seven, because that's when we gathered together in the living room, and the wonderful world of Disney took us on a magic carpet.
Upon a star, makes no difference who you are, anything your heart desires will come to you. If your heart is in your dream, no request is too extreme.
When you say the word Disney to me, it brings to mind you can. Anything you want to be, you can be if you believe in yourself. That's what I think about. If you wish upon a star, makes no difference who you are, anything your heart desire will come to you.
On this program, a bit of magic. That's what the show is all about. You know, when I arrive at the studio in the morning, my desk is always nice and neat. But it doesn't take long for it to look like this. However, instead of bothering my busy secretaries with house cleaning problems, I tidy up myself. It's really quite easy. Watch. Now, here we go. A one, a two. That's it. Huh? Scripts, come on, get over there. Get over there where you belong. Correspondence. Neat. Make a neat pile. That's it. Pencils, come on. Pencils. Now, come on, paper clips. Come on, get them.
Sunday nights, we would be in my grandmother's living room, and there would come Walt Disney on the screen. It was something that you could share with everyone, and it always gave you joy.
Hi there. You know, this is one of my favorite times of the day here, just about sundown. I like to be around when the lights come on. It seems like a new kind of magic takes over in Disneyland after dark.
What is really special about Disney is he gave us a Magic Kingdom, both at Disneyland and also a Magic Kingdom of the imagination. He represents some of the best of us, the dreams, and the sheer pleasure of being a child.
Hello, Donald.
That's me. Where am I?
Mathemagic Land.
Mathemagic Land? Never heard of it.
It's the land of great adventure.
Now, who are you?
I'm a spirit, the true spirit of adventure.
That's for me. What's next?
A journey through the wonderland of mathematics.
Mathematics?
Well, I believe that the magic of Disney is that it was a realm where children could believe in magic. And I remember it was, in some ways, there was a melancholy to watching Disney because I knew the weekend was over. I just remember thinking that was like the last gas station before you hit the school desert.
I think the entire audience had already been preconditioned by Walt Disney's cartoons. And so I think he touched all segments of the audience, and they all came to witness his entry into this new medium.
Walt Disney's Disneyland.
40 years ago, on October 27th, 1954, Disneyland the series debuted on ABC, giving the public its first glimpse of the happiest place on Earth.
Each week, as you enter this timeless land, one of these many worlds will open to you. Frontierland. Tall tales and true from the legendary past.
Disneyland was a dream that almost didn't come true. In the early 1950s, Walt couldn't beg or borrow the $17 million it would take to build the park. One sleepless night, he came up with a solution: television. In exchange for presenting Disney on TV, ABC helped finance America's first theme park, and the television series made it world famous.
Here now to tell you about it is Walt Disney.
Welcome. I guess you all know this little fella here. It's an old partnership. Mickey and I started out the first time many, many years ago. We've had a lot of our dreams come true. Now we want you to share with us our latest and greatest dream. That's it, right here. Disneyland, seen from about 2,000 feet in the air and 10 months away. I want to tell you about it because later on in the show, you'll find that Disneyland the place and Disneyland the TV show are all part of the same.
It's astonishing to me how many people come up to me and say, thank you for the television shows, you know, because I grew up on those. And I think Hollywood was generally pretty scared of television in the early 50s. And I think it was after we'd been on the air for the first couple of years that it really began to be seen as a genuine form of entertainment and for product.
We hope that through our television shows that you will join us and take part in the building of Disneyland, and that you'll find here a place of knowledge and happiness.
Don't adjust your dial. There's nothing wrong with your television. Back in 1955, if you wanted to see me in color, you were living in fantasy land. As far as Disney was concerned, the state of the art was a sad state of affairs. Even though Disneyland the series was making television history and 100 million people were tuning in each week, Walt still wasn't satisfied. Black and white just didn't suit a man who dreamed in color. What the public didn't know was that Walt had the foresight to film many of his shows in color. And tonight, we'll see a number of them that way for the first time.
And now, your Disneyland host, Walt Disney.
The world we live in would look pretty dull if Mother Nature used a black and white palette and painted only in shades of gray like this. That was the situation when I first stepped into the entertainment world some 40 years ago. One vital dimension was still missing: color. It was an impractical dream, something at the end of the rainbow. But in our business, dreams have a way of coming true. Color does brighten things up, doesn't it? Yes, color gives us an exciting dimension to add to our program. It is such a fascinating topic that we've invited the world's foremost authority to throw some light on the subject.
You want to know how color TV works?
He's a renowned scientist, lecturer, psychologist, world traveler, my old friend and longtime associate, Professor Ludwig Von Drake.
Now, everybody knows you have a camera. Now, the picture comes in here, and it's broken down into three primaries, and it's picked up by election tubes. After the primaries...
The Wonderful World of Color premiered Sunday night, September 24th, 1961, along with an eccentric new character, Donald Duck's uncle. Professor Ludwig Von Drake was television's leading expert on just about everything.
What's this? This doesn't even belong here. Besides, what do you want to bother your head about all this technical stuff? It's very simple. All you do is turn this little knob, and you've got your picture. See? That's all. All right, come on. You turned a little knob, and you got the picture. All right, I turned a knob. Didn't I turn the knob? What are you doing with that? I guess it takes some time to warm up. I don't know about this. Oh, this is murder.
Color.
I distinctly remember the first time I saw The Wonderful World of Color in something other than black and white. And to watch the opening credits in color, that was a mesmerizing thing, with flowers blooming and Tinkerbell flying around. And that song, "The World is a Carousel of Color, Wonderful, Wonderful Color."
The world is a carousel of color. History, comedy, fantasy. There's drama and mirth. There's old Mother Earth with all of her secrets to see. The miracle of imagination. The marvels of earth, sea, and sky. These wonders untold are ours to behold in the funny world, the sunny world, the wonderful world.
Forty years of television magic brought to you by Chevy Lumina. The features you want, the safety you need, at an affordable price that's genuine Chevrolet.
Master, there is a great disturbance in the Force. Get his battery. If you only knew the power of the dark side.
Still going. Long-lasting Energizer batteries keep going and going.
Fasten your seat belts. It's going to be a bumpy night. I always love that line. And now, all about Toontown, an animated place where cartoons are king. The word animate means to give life. And over the years, that's exactly what Disney has done. Through four decades of television, Disney cartoon characters have become familiar faces in our living rooms. Everyone knows someone like these guys. Donald Duck was a prototype for going ballistic. Before there was Laid Back, there was Goofy. And as far as good-looking hunks go, there have been two great movie stars with big ears, Clark Gable and Mickey Mouse.
Most American boys and girls, I grew up with Mickey Mouse. The early comic strips and his adventures, which were real cliffhangers, had a big influence on me when I was a kid. I think the thing that set Disney apart in terms of his innovation was, first and foremost, that he gave personalities to the characters. Mickey Mouse was the first cartoon character to have a real personality, and a personality you could identify with.
By 1955, Mickey Mouse was the most durable movie star in history, and his TV fan club made him a folk hero for a new generation of children.
Who's the leader of the club that's made for you and me?
M-I-C-K-E-Y-M-O-U-S-E.
Hey there, hi there, ho there, you're as welcome as can be.
M-I-C-K-E-Y-M-O-U-S-E.
Mickey Mouse.
Mickey Mouse.
Forever let us hold our banner high.
Walt had always wanted to do a television show for children, and I don't think we all realized the impact that Mickey Mouse was having on the kids of America, and you know, afterwards and looking back, think how lucky we were to be on such a classic American show.
Mouseketeers, roll call, count off now.
Disney was always looking for the kids next door. He wanted the kids at home to be able to associate with us. He didn't want slick professionals who would have staged voices and be phonies. And everybody wanted to be a Mouseketeer. I mean, and it was a great babysitter. I mean, the mothers could put their kids in front of that TV from 5 to 6 every day and make dinner, and at 6 o'clock, dinner's ready, the kids are finished with the Mickey Mouse Club, everybody was happy. You know, it was just a daily ritual. People didn't want to miss that cereal, and they wanted to see what the Mouseketeers were going to sing and dance that day.
After school, the Mickey Mouse Club came on. I remember America's heart throb. My first big love was Annette Funicello. Beautiful little Annette. And the Spinning Marty. Oh, I faithfully watched Spinning Marty.
Mickey Mouse Club presents Further Adventures of Spinning Marty. Starring Tim Considine, David Stollery, Annette Funicello.
How old are you, Annette?
16.
Girls get all the breaks.
In what way?
Well, when a girl's 16, she can get married if she wants to. But a guy has to wait until he's 21 or so.
Some boys get married when they're only 19.
Oh, yeah, if they're going into the service or something. But a guy really shouldn't get married until he's got a job. Or at least knows what he's going to do. I mean, what kind of career he's gonna pick, or what kind of business.
That's what I think, Spin.
He should at least be, well, sort of started out in life so he can support a girl before he gets married.
My folks feel that way, too.
It helps out, I guess. Kind of expensive getting married. Well, shall we get on with the play?
I love the Mickey Mouse Club. But the part I hated most is when I knew the kids were coming out to sing M-I-C.
Now it's time to say goodbye.
I would get sad every time I'd hear it. It hurt every day.
M-I-C.
See you real soon.
K-E-Y.
Why? Because we like you.
Mickey's appeal
Walt Disney once explained, was the triumph of the little guy. A nice fellow who never does anybody any harm. The same could not be said for his best friend. Everything Mickey did right, Donald Duck did wrong. Mickey's success on television was a never-ending torment to this temperamental, foul-tempered fowl.
When you're the sidekick, people think you want to be the number one guy. Well, Donald Duck had the same thing. Everything would be great for Mickey Mouse and not so great for Donald Duck. You watched him get flustered and all, moving around. His feet would go a mile a minute and his arms would fluster. He's the last angry man.
Donald's legendary temper was a source of inspiration for many of Disney's most memorable television shows, including
Donald,
A Day in the Life of Donald Duck.
I can't understand a word you say.
That's the last one.
Yes, Mr. Duck?
Send my voice head here.
Your voice? Oh, Clarence Nash. Yes, I'll send him right in.
Hi, Donald. Boy, what a beautiful day for the little creatures.
What's good about it?
Why, the birds are singing.
The reason Donald Duck could get away with being such a jerk was because he wore that tight, tight sailor outfit and no pants.
In The Plausible Impossible, Walt himself tested the limits of Donald's temper.
Now you take a real heavy object, say something weighing 3 or 4 tons. This can produce some very plausible effects, both audible and visual. First, the sound, which was made by letting a steel tank drop 10 feet onto the concrete floor of an empty swimming pool, with reverberation added. Now here's an unusual effect. When a character is shot out of a cannon, Donald, the people are waiting.
Goofy was another favorite Disney character. Straight out of vaudeville, his television bits inspired generations of performers.
Goofy, I think, is one of the greatest physical comedians ever lived. I sometimes wish I could do that with my body.
That was so, so funny, especially when they would do it in slow motion. And they would just show his body reacting to some object he's either bouncing off of or heading towards, you know, the facial reactions. Everything, it was just wonderful stuff.
Only the magic of the slow motion camera can do justice to the grace and beauty of this spectacle. As man and beast responding simultaneously to the gentle undulation glide through space with a wave-like motion.
I would rank Goofy probably around
by a gentle
zephyr from the likes of De Niro, Pacino, certainly Brando.
There's great soul in Goofy, great soul, great heart. That to me is the vitality of the character.
He's worth $1 million.
He's worth $2 million.
$2,500,000.
$3 million.
$4 million.
$750,000.
What do you mean? $5 million.
Six.
Seven.
Eight. Nine.
$50 a week for 48 years.
You're all vacant.
I think Goofy's probably the perfect physical comic. He's what every human comic hopes he could be. You know, he can tie himself into a pretzel. He can fall out of a 15-story building and bounce.
Oh! Okay, Dad.
Oh! Get me down out of here!
I think the animated characters really live inside of us, because they are our thoughts and our hopes. And we see them on television slamming against the wall, bang, and they wake up. You know, they never die. They never get old, and they live forever.
Spin it! Let's begin it. Spin it.
As Disney's animated family continues to grow, its characters have entered a new era of television history, embracing the magic of the past. The newest character here in Mickey's Toontown is a bunny with big problems. He was supposed to give me a lift to Frontierland. Here he comes now. Anyway, Roger Rabbit made his first television appearance on Mickey's 60th birthday broadcast. Roger, hold it. Well, right. And he's been messing things up ever since. Roger, excuse me!
Cue the fanfare! Cue Mickey!
Cue Mickey!
I'd like to thank all of you for coming tonight. And to all of you out there at home, gosh, thanks for watching the show. It's great to be here.
I quit.
Kmart's kids' clothes come with this great guarantee. I wish my kids did. It's called the kid-proof policy. A Kmart extra. You're gonna love this. Kmart actually guarantees their kids' clothes. If you're not satisfied with how they hold up, wear, tear, whatever, Kmart will exchange them or give you a refund. I'm glad something's kid-proof around here.
This year, thousands of people will invest in the promise of new technology in the 1995 Toyota Corolla. And now, with a Corolla lease starting at only $189 a month, you can enjoy the technology of a sophisticated sound chamber that dramatically reduces noise levels, advanced safety systems like standard dual airbags, plus air conditioning, power steering, and AM/FM four-speaker stereo. At only $189 a month, the Toyota Corolla is the benchmark of quality and the promise of value.
Hey, get this. They've improved Cheerios.
They've improved Cheerios?
Now, is that legal?
Cheerios is better. Go ahead, try it.
I'll take that challenge.
Now Cheerios is golden toasted to stay crispier longer in milk for a better, crispier taste.
It even looks better.
And still with only 1 gram of sugar.
Much crispier.
Yeah. Okay, you've proven your case.
Looking for a different way to spice up dinner? Take a new look at cheese. Think of cheese as a zesty way to perk up your chicken. Or cheese as a tangy topping for tastier fries.
Awesome. Give American food a new life
to cheese. How do I love thee? Let me count the chips. 1, 2, hey, there's more chips.
50% more.
That makes Pillsbury chocolate chip cookies more chocolatey tasting than ever.
I gotta hand it to you.
Not that hand.
Sunday, their car's given out.
Now what?
So all the Jericho kids pitch in.
Where do I start?
Well, almost.
When it comes to fixing cars, my idea of manual labor is reading from the manual.
On our own, after America's Funniest Home Videos, Sunday here on ABC.
40 years of Disney television magic will continue in a moment here on ABC. From Steven Spielberg, a network television premiere.
Daddy!
With Robin Williams.
Are you related to Mighty Mouse?
Julia Roberts and Dustin Hoffman as Hook, Sunday at 8, 7 Central on ABC.
When
outside, there's nothing like getting underneath the Sunbeam automatic blanket. Not only is it a great way to stay warm and toasty, but a Sunbeam blanket saves money because it heats you and not the whole house. So give someone you care about a Sunbeam automatic blanket, because everybody deserves a little warmth this time of year.
Right now at TJ Maxx, find gifts for everyone on your list. Top designer fashions, fabulous brand name gifts, sweaters, jackets, great stocking stuffers, luxurious 100% silk, bath oils, silver and crystal, for her, for him, for kids. Our biggest gift selection ever. Save up to 60% on top name gifts for everyone, including you, all in one place. So hurry to TJ Maxx.
AT&T announces a world without limits. Introducing the only international calling plan with no people to pick, no countries to choose, no minimums to pay. It's AT&T True World Savings, the simplest calling plan in the world. Save 40% to everyone, everywhere, in every country. It's a world without limits, only from AT&T.
Your true voice.
American Eagle Service out of Chicago suspended. Details at 10.
When I was a little girl, I didn't play house. I built forts. So with a few cardboard boxes and a little imagination, Custer made his last stand in my backyard. And the Alamo didn't fall till dinner time. To Disney, imagination was the most important frontier. Drawn to the pioneer spirit and searching for new TV characters, the Disney Studios turned its attention to the stories and legends that sprang from American soil.
Born on a mountaintop in Tennessee, green estate in the land of the free, raised in the woods so's he knew every tree, killed him a bear when he was only three. Davy Crockett, King of the Wild Frontier.
Davy Crockett was TV's first miniseries, and it made a star out of an unknown actor named Bess Parker. At first, he didn't want to play the role. He didn't like wearing leather breeches, and he was allergic to horses. Nevertheless, Bess Parker's Davy Crockett came to personify traditions that Americans continue to cherish.
I personally love Davy Crockett. He was the Indiana Jones of that time. He had his gang, he had his pack. And they would get the job done. He was our great American hero. And he had a great sense of humor. That was important. To grin your way out of trouble.
You want to see me, General?
That's right. Come inside. Now, how'd you kill that brute?
With my knife? I was figuring on grinning him to death, but this here stumble-footed major has come along and busted up my concentrate.
Grin him to death? What in thunderation is that?
Oh, it's something I've been experimenting with. You see, there's nothing so absolutely unresistible as an old-fashioned, good-natured grin. Like this.
God. That was, I kind of dreaded that scene.
Ah!
Well, I worked on a bar.
I spend 5 to 10 hours a weekend meeting people, and they come up and they say, in effect, my life values were shaped by that show.
Why you no kill me?
Maybe because of another law. We have trouble living up to it. Thou shalt not kill.
I think that there's an underlying core to the American personality. This core of values, which really came out of hard work, family cooperation. Walt Disney brought all of that to the screen.
I know who you are. Since when is Davy Crockett a friend of Indians?
Allis been a friend of the Cherokees. Got no bones to pick with the others since we signed the peace with them.
Take a powerful lot of argument to convince me of that.
That's what I come for.
There was no way Davy could be beat, where if he was challenged, they would leg wrestle. But of course, Davy was able to wrap his leg, catch the other fella, and just pull him right over.
Hey,
Davy, you know.
You know, he'd come through again.
What made David Crockett so appealing was strength. Born on the mountaintop of Tennessee, was able to strike out and wrestle bears when he was a kid. And then he had a certain hat to go along with it that it wasn't a cowboy hat. It wasn't anyone's hat but David Crockett. We all wanted that hat.
Thanks to the enormous popularity of the television series, Davy Crockett's coonskin cap quickly became a national craze. Life magazine said, "It has come down to a question of who will be exhausted first, raccoons or the parents who have to buy the caps."
I went to 13 foreign countries with the movie, and it was the same in Sweden as it was in Great Britain or in France. I mean, the coonskin cap and the little toy rifle were the most desired items that many children in the world ever wanted.
Disney's great contribution to folk and fairy tales was to give them an American flavor. Once Upon a Time and Happily Ever After became stories about rags to riches, staking your claim, passing the torch. These were the themes that Walt explored again and again as he spun his yarns, using television as his campfire.
Long time ago, there was a masked rider who rode the countryside. This was an old Spanish California, back in the days of high adventure and low, soft guitar.
When the full moon is bright, comes the horseman known as Zorro. This bold renegade carves a Z with his blade, a Z that stands for...
It was a pretty positive role model, because you could carve a Z in your underwear. I mean, you know, if you can do that, like, who's not going to like you? Zorro! Nobody could tell who he was because he had this mask. It was kind of like Superman with his glasses, you know. It's dressed in black. There's something about the guy that dresses in black when you're a kid.
Beautiful. Cooperate to the wall. You must show me that again, Commandante. Now, would you please get inside the cell?
The great thing about Zorro, he was a essentially Spanish-Mexican guy putting the white guys in jail, which I kind of dug myself.
Next week, watch Monasterio bait the trap for his mortal enemy. Zorro is wanted, dead or alive. Watch Zorro spring the trap as he matches cold steel with the cruel tyrant. Ride with Zorro, champion of the oppressed and defender of justice, next week, when the Walt Disney Studio brings you another thrilling adventure of Zorro.
Boy, oh boy, was Zorro a real person?
I'm afraid not, Moochie. You see, Zorro's a mythical character. He's something of our imagination. What's that?
That's your imagination.
Señores y señoritas.
Zorro.
Disney's love of the American frontier soon inspired a series of tall tale television cartoons.
Howdy, neighbors. I suppose y'all is wondering how come me and my partner Hyman here is all gussied up in this here western-type duds. And how come all this cow-pokey talk? Gesundheit! Well, it's simple. We are talking cowboy talk because the next tale I'm gonna tell is an old pioneer-type story. It's a real tall, western-type, tall tale type about an hombre named Pecos Bill.
Yahoo!
Yahoo! Whoa! Pecos Bill was quite a cowboy down in Texas, and a western Superman, to say the least.
He was the roughest, toughest critter, never known to be a quitter, cause he never had no fear of man or beast. So yippee-yi-yay, yippee-yi-yo, for the
once he wrote the raging cyclone out of nowhere. Then he straddled it and settled down with ease. And while that cyclone bucked and flitted, Pecos rolled the smoke and lit it. And he tamed that ornery wind down to a breeze.
So yippee-yay-yay.
Pecos Bill, he was a hero man in the Wild West, and he had a great sense of humor.
I think that's part of the American spirit. It's the American grin. It's that Robert Redford, you know, it's... Times are tough, but don't forget your sense of humor. You know, keep that going along with what you're doing, and I'm sure you'll get through it in some way.
Short Gunderson's my name. I'm river foreman of a timber camp near the Oregon Trail. My outfit was mighty discouraged the day Paul Bunyan arrived. We were getting plenty of timber in the river, but we couldn't move it to the sawmills because the river was so dead burn crooked. Paul looked the situation over careful-like. Then he harnessed Babe with a yoke, hitched on a big anchor, and threw it in at the head of the river.
Yep, Babe!
In the wonderful world of Disney, heroes weren't always big, handsome lumberjacks or cowboys who loved yodel. Sometimes they were right in our own backyards. Sometimes they were even girls.
Pollyanna was a girl who brought happiness to an unhappy town, armed with a single weapon, her optimism.
Hello? Come here. Come right over here.
You have a stubby little nose. What do you think about that?
I know it. I wish I were pretty like you.
Oh, don't you try to.
I think Polly is the kind of character that underlies so many of the Disney movies. How a child's innocence and honesty and love can change a whole community of people.
Original Pollyanna was an enormous success.
Oh, Angelica, call the doctor quickly.
It's just something about that story that rings true, that actually strikes to the very heart of us all.
Hi, honey. You're going to be fine, don't you worry. Goodbye, darling. We're going to visit you in the hospital.
Hey, Snooky, take a look at this, will you?
Really? You mean really? You did it. Oh, Nancy, it's gorgeous,
isn't it? And we're going to wait for you. You're going to be my flower girl.
She's a marvelous character, and we know that this is how we ought to be, without allowing ourselves to get sort of squashed by the problems and the disappointments and the setbacks in life.
In 1989, Debbie Allen directed a new version of this classic tale for Disney's television audience. Pollyanna became Polly. Here, this story's timeless message finds new residents as Polly unites a segregated southern town.
A lot of people here today have worked very hard to make our first annual bazaar a success. And now they're all pretty tired, every one of them. So, we have declared a Polly Day, amen.
Amen.
So that we may get some rest, and so that we will not forget that we all need each other here in this town, amen.
I think films make a big difference in our lives because they're so powerful, the images are so vivid and so real. And if we can project that kind of power in a certain direction, we really can alter consciousness.
Plenty of time
like the movie with Alfred Woodard, with that scene with the boys and not being able to break the matches when they're all together. You know, divided, we are conquered. Together, we cannot fail. We cannot be separated.
Break it in two.
A mother's courage is the true story of basketball star Isaiah Thomas and his mother's struggle to raise her family as a family.
It's easy to break one, but you can't do it with 10. These sticks are like a family. Together, we're strong. We can help each other. But alone, we just alone and a little weak. Don't ever forget that.
All of these heroes and heroines that Disney sort of documented over the years, they all kind of come out of the same idea that all these people were pioneers. They all had so much moral integrity. It's such an interesting thing that they're all from different backgrounds, yet they still had the same kind of themes running through, the same values, and they were all just kind of teaching them in different ways.
The word is acronym.
Acronym. A C R O N Y M. Acronym.
In the true story of Cambodian refugee Lin Yan, Disney Television embraced America's most cherished value, freedom.
When Lin Yan arrived from Cambodia, she spoke no English at all. That was 1979.
Acronym.
Now, 4 years
That's
later,
the word 12-year-old Lin Yan spelled to win the Hamilton County Zone 5 spelling bee last night. Now, what makes this so...
I'm glad to be in America. I was a slave. Now I can do anything I want to do. I'm proud of the people who love me and my family. I am free.
Ultra intense. We have major pressures. So Secret made something revolutionary for us. Ultra Dry. This is huge. Keeps you drier than any other kind out there. A new pH balanced soft solid that goes on dry and vanishes like that. So two clicks give us ultimate dryness. Our lives demand it. New Secret Ultra Dry. Strong enough for him. But now the ultimate in dryness for us.
On a day like this, you're bound to see quite a few great performances on the ice. But few are as gripping as the Lumina minivan. Its available traction control system keeps you sure-footed even in the worst weather. Lumina. It looks different because it is different.
This is historic soup because it was cooked in the past. This is new Kettle Creations. Delicious soups with pasta and beans you cook up fresh. So you can make history, or you can make soup. New Lipton Kettle Creations. Soup so good, it's uncanny.
We topped the ultimate test of a household cleaner with the worst. 409 Glass and Surface Cleaner cuts grease and cleans glass. Even grease on glass without streaking. 409 Glass and Surface Cleaner. It cuts the grease. It cleans the glass.
Let's talk about the difference between fine jewelry and expensive fine jewelry. Fine jewelry comes from Target, where it's priced sensibly low every single day. It's real 14-karat gold and makes just as nice a gift as jewelry that could cost you lots more. In fact, the only real difference between Target's fine jewelry and expensive fine jewelry is that they make you pay big bucks for a little bitty box.
If you thought these were legendary twosomes, wait till the pros pair up. Golf's best play the final round of the Diners Club matches tomorrow on ABC.
Superman tries to save the world, but loses his memory instead. Now, is it too late?
The sky literally is falling.
Lois and Clark, Saturday at 10, 9 Central.
Walt Disney once declared, Disneyland will never be completed as long as there is imagination in the world. Welcome to the Indiana Jones adventure, and behold the Temple of the Forbidden Eye. According to ancient superstition, one look at the god within means certain doom. It was discovered in 1935 by daredevil archaeologist Indiana Jones, and will soon be rediscovered by the public. Walt's original inspiration for Disneyland came from his experience as a father. Back in the 1940s, he took his daughters to amusement parks. Critical of the cheap rides, the smell of beer and hot dogs, he wondered, why isn't there a pleasant place for families to spend time together? A vision grew in his mind, a vision he shared each week on TV's most popular new series.
On our first television program, we showed you a blueprint for a dream. Well, this is the blueprint, and the dream is Disneyland, the park that we're constructing near Anaheim, California. We promised to keep you informed as our dream became a reality. So, for a first-hand progress report, let's visit Disneyland now.
What the hurry, what the worry, why the bustle and the hustle, why the concentration and sudden inspiration?
It's because the date's been planned to open Disneyland.
The frontier gate is set up and there can't be any let up. We must do our best to finish all together. Hurry, 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 there's no time to sit and worry. Check the castle, fill the lake, or see, for goodness sake.
Make a rocket, that's exciting,
a boat trip, that's inviting.
The time is ticking fast, and we've got to finish fast, but we'll be there when they open Disneyland.
On July 17, 1955, Walt Disney cast open the gates of Disneyland. Millions watched as the festivities were broadcast live on a coast-to-coast telecast.
How do you do, everyone? This is Hank Weaver. For the past year, this signature has announced the opening of Disneyland, the show. Now, it announces the opening of Disneyland, the place. The world's most fabulous kingdom will be unveiled before an invitational world premiere, and you are guests. Art Linkletter will be your host, and with ABC crews and cameras on the spot, we'll guide you through this truly magic land.
Walt Disney asked me if I would ask a couple of my friends who were quick-witted and good with words to come and join Walt and me as the hosts. So I asked Bob Cummings, the wonderful comic actor, and Ronnie Reagan, who was my neighbor down at Holmby Hills. And so the four of us set out with no rehearsal and a few notes and dived into a coast-to-coast show together.
Well, this job in the next hour and a half is going to be a delight. I feel like Santa Claus with a $17 million bundle of gift packages all wrapped in whimsy and sent your way over television with the help of 29 cameras.
Despite the best-laid plans of mice and men, almost nothing went smoothly on opening day. Now, of course,
Disneyland opening was finally called Black Sunday because the crowds were bigger than they ever expected. The heat was higher than we'd ever anticipated. There were overloads on electricity which blew up rides and stopped lighting. You could hardly get anybody to pay attention to you.
A vista into a world of wondrous ideas, signifying man's achievements. I thought I got a signal.
One time I had to rush to over by the Toad ride, and there was a pile of lumber nearby, and they'd put the microphone under it so nobody would see it and steal it. And of course, I couldn't find it either. And I knew from the script that Bob Cummings was going to send it to me inside of 20 seconds.
Oh, you're waiting for me? Oh, thank you. Everybody is waving at Bob Cummings over here, so I guess I'm back on. And oh, and I see Art Linkletter right now. Art Linkletter is looking for a microphone. He looks all confused. He's standing over there in front of the Mr. Toad's Wild Ride. And I think if...
Yes, there were many little things like that. Walt was very proud and very nervous for the first time.
Now the plaque reserved for last. A few words of dedication for the happiest kingdom of them all, Fantasyland. Here is a world of imagination, hopes, and dreams. In this timeless land of enchantment, the age of chivalry, magic, and make-believe are reborn, and fairy tales come true. Fantasyland is dedicated to the young and the young in heart, to those who believe that when you wish upon a star, your dreams do come true.
Open the Fantasyland Castle in the name of the children of the world.
Disneyland is really kind of haunted for all of us who were there that first day. It's very gratifying to see the park got bigger. We moved the railroad track I don't know how many times. I don't think it would have surprised Walt at all.
To a kid growing up in the 1950s, Disneyland was Oz and Walt the Wizard. Each and every Sunday night, the wonderful world of Disney gave us a peek behind his magic curtain.
The best episodes of that show always began with Walt standing around in his office.
This is what we call our Imagineering Department. It's where we dream up our new projects.
And there were some of those shows in which Walt would just be in his office, and it seemed like he'd talk for 45 minutes, and then they show some clips of technicians working on robots or something like that. Those were always the best. Those are the most fascinating.
The building of Disneyland gave us a new art and a new type of artist, one that works with a slide rule and a blowtorch instead of pencil and brush.
It was literally this very, very pleasant man sitting there and telling us about these wonderful things that were coming our way.
This is the carousel theater host. Whatever the man in the harness does, this figure will respond simultaneously in the same manner. Would you care for a light? I don't think we better. No smoking on the stage.
He was a kind of a technology freak in a lot of ways. And then, of course, when he was building Disneyland, he also wanted people to, first of all, see how it was being built, and second, see, for instance, how the audio animatronic figures work.
Audio animatronics?
Right, audio animatronics. Audio for sound.
See, and electronically animated by sound. That's what he's trying to say.
Thank you, that's what I was trying to say.
Excuse me, Walt.
Well, the word animatronics today is accepted as a form of creating any robotics for film. We use it freely. Animatronics. The fact of the matter is that the word animatronics comes from Disney.
What you are seeing is a man operating a machine that activates the mechanical features of this head. As a matter of fact, every movement and sound of all the tenants of the Haunted Mansion is directed in this manner.
Send us a message from somewhere beyond.
Everything I think that Disney stood for and everything he brought to us was so universal in how it touched you. Disney put a smile on our faces. He let us kids think like kids, and as we grew up, we continued to think those thoughts.
As the moon climbs high over the dead oak tree, creepy creeps with eerie eyes. Grim grinning ghosts come out to socialize.
I would like a table for Christmas.
I want a bunny rabbit.
A hammer.
On a green couch.
I want a little puppy.
When a moment matters this much, catch it on Kodak's newest film, Kodak Royal Gold. Extra sharp, extra clear for the details you'll save for a lifetime.
How are you going to come down with your chimney, with your fat tummy?
Kodak Royal Gold for the holidays, for the moments that matter most.
Over the years, some pretty hungry folks have stopped by my place.
The Mega Meal from KFC is back.
That's like Mega Meal.
Your choice of chicken, a ton of side dishes, even a whole pie, just $14.99. And this week, get a Wile E. Coyote mug.
Must be his mugshot.
Just $1.99 with every Mega Meal. Collect all four. The Mega Meal from KFC. Enough food to feed your whole family. Oh, one Tasmanian devil.
Someday soon, there'll be superhero lunchboxes, big yellow school buses, and new best friends. So now's the time to Johnson's baby them. With clinically proven baby care that's healthful enough, mild enough, even for a newborn. No wonder it's the number one choice of hospitals. They'll grow up soon enough. Now while you can, protect them, shelter them. Johnson's baby them.
My nickname at Walmart is the singing cashier. Singing is something I enjoy doing. This brings out the Christmas joy in a person. I sing to my customers. Each time they come in the store, I'm always singing. And not only that, when they leave, I'm singing, so. And they walk away with the biggest smile on their face, like, wow. Not only makes me happy, but it makes them happy also. Knowing that, hey, she did it for me, you know.
We try to make your day a little brighter, holiday time or any time.
That's my definition of the Christmas spirit.
Maybe he locked us in so he wouldn't be all alone on Christmas Eve.
Can a Grinch learn the meaning of Christmas?
Can't Mr. Dreghorn have dinner at our house?
Mickey Rooney guests on Full House.
Everybody, just suck it in and smile.
Then, how does the Tower family spell Happy Holidays?
Merry Christmas from the Wee Rocks.
It's Me and the Boys, Tuesday on ABC.
40 years of Disney television magic will continue in a moment here on ABC.
Who could bring together some of music's biggest stars on a special appearance by Priscilla Presley? Only the King.
You're looking for trouble?
For the first time on network television.
You came to the right place.
You'll see rare footage and go inside Graceland. It's an incredible night honoring the King. John Stamos hosts Elvis, the tribute, Thursday here on ABC.
Now, the award-winning family luxury sedan Chrysler Concord comes with all the perks. The options you want at tremendous savings. Performance perks, a 3.5-liter V6, APS. Enjoyable perks, remote keyless entry, CD player. Comfortable perks, leather trim, and more. Now is the best time of the year to purchase or lease Chrysler Concord with up to $1,130 in option discounts and package values. Concord perks, but only for a limited time. See the stars of Chicagoland, your Chrysler Plymouth dealers.
Sprint would like to demonstrate what happens when you take away the limitations of time and space. Introducing Sprint Worldwide, the first international calling plan that is truly global, with a 20% savings on anyone, anytime, anywhere you call, in America and across the world, forever.
Hey! Hey! I'm walking here!
Sprint Worldwide, far and away, the world's first truly global calling plan.
Happy holidays from your favorite soap stars at 10.
You know, one of the reasons I wanted to marry Walt Disney when I was a kid is so that I could hang out with all these cool animals. The secret of a genuine adventure requires a little bit of danger, a lot of suspense, and it doesn't hurt to bring along a good sense of humor. The wonderful world of Disney showed us that adventure could be found, well, almost anywhere. Armed with cameras and curiosity, film crews wandered the globe in search of excitement. Television became a safari as Disney explored nature in the wild. Before had wild animals been observed so intimately, so humanely. Many of these groundbreaking sequences were filmed by trained naturalists who endured storms, floods, sub-zero temperatures, and even swarms of locusts. To capture this spectacular footage, ingenious methods were often required. One cameraman disguised himself as a buffalo so he could mingle with the herd. Another waited 6 weeks beside an alligator egg in order to photograph it hatching. Where nature led, Disney cameras followed.
Nature is a mystery to a lot of people because they live in the cities and apartments. Oh, they drive through it perhaps, but they don't get to sit for a long time. When I go out, I sit for a long time at one spot, maybe all day. And you get to see nature. You get to realize, hey, that bird's after something. He's just flying over. He's after something. You got to remember, they're doing something all the time, not just sightseeing. Animals don't sightsee.
The nature shows touch that sense of adventure in me. I mean, I wanted to go to these places. I wanted to touch and to sense exactly what was shown. And the photography was beautiful. It was very much educational as it was visual, not just a television show. He opened up your world. I mean, when you look back at it, Disney opened up your world.
When Disney's Academy Award-winning production of The Living Desert came to television, it gave the public a new appreciation for life in the wild. Programs showed animals in a new light, their courage, their character,
and their surprisingly human personalities.
We come to the story of Skinny, the bravado squirrel. For openers, Skinny seems to want to join his fellows in all that's going on in the colony. Nope. Non-members of this club are simply not welcome. Suddenly, Skinny and his problems are forgotten when a real social outcast sticks his nose in things. The Gila monster looks like a beaded bag, a bag packed with poison. For all the pretty appearance, it's the venomous lizard in this part of the world, and the fellow to be met with caution. So the party breaks up in panic as the squirrels flee the enemy. There's one, though, who chooses to stand pat. That's Skinny. It's hard to say if he's long on grit or short on common sense. Either way, he seems to have taken the monster's measure. Outgambled and outmaneuvered, the reptile moves on to peddle his poison somewhere else. Who's the hero of the hour? A newest member of the gang? Skinny, naturally. And naturally, he gets a big hand. And all a member's privileges.
We were not unique, but darn near it for a long, long time in that field. In the nature realm, certainly, I think we were very much pioneers. That was at the time when DDT was at its worst. And the falcons in particular were being affected by it, by the thinning of the eggshells. When they'd, being at the top of the food chain, they would eat all these little animals that had been eating DDT-infested grain or whatever. And the populations were going down really, really dramatically. But DDT is a petroleum derivative chemical. And one of our sponsors, as it happened, was an oil company, which will remain unnamed. So I got every writer in the studio in the room, and I said, okay, let's get these guys. And the show went on the air, got the highest rating of the year. And within a year, DDT had been banned. Well, I always felt enormously proud of that. And I think it talks a lot about the kind of educational things that we did through the years.
I love this elephant. You know, to Disney, the greatest adventure of all is childhood. In a series of beloved classics, the studio explored the trials and tribulations of growing up.
Toby! Toby Tyler! Toby!
Many of these feature films later reached wider audiences on television. Toby Tyler examines that American childhood fantasy, running away from home to join the circus.
I wanted to be a knife thrower in the circus, so I tore up all my mother's kitchen when I was trying to throw knives so I could join the circus. And every kid on the street was walking tight ropes and, you know, breaking legs trying to be Toby Tyler.
Look out, boy. Don't rile him.
Careful with that gun. Easy. Easy, Mr. Stubbs. Easy. Give it to me. Please? No, Mr. Stubbs! No! Stubbs! It's too late to be sorry now. Come on.
Disney was drawn to the greatest adventure stories in world literature. In a Robert Louis Stevenson tale of high seas adventure, the studio explored a classic childhood fear, being kidnapped.
Come back! Come back! Bring back that boat!
Walt always seemed to see things through the eyes of a young person. I mean, he was a very smart man, but he had this wonderful gift of retaining the quality of youth and being able to relate to young people.
Are you afraid, Mr. Balfour?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir, I am.
Bravely said. There's many a fine, handsome gentleman who wouldn't have dared to say it.
Fear is nothing to be ashamed of. It's just how you handle it. And I think Walt, again, he knew from his perspective, he knew that a young person who can admit that he's afraid has strength.
Disney's most popular adventure of all put a family of castaways on an island full of pirates and wild animals. Back in the 60s, millions of kids dreamed of being shipwrecked with Swiss Family Robinson.
What happened?
She's hit something.
The Swiss Family Robinson made such an impact on me. I mean, the treehouse itself was something that, you know, it was just, I mean, you didn't want to live in a house. You wanted that treehouse. You grew up all your life going, one day I'm going to have a treehouse just like that, you know?
If the Swiss Family Robinson treehouse is the most indelible of all the film's images, then the ostrich race must run a close second.
In Swiss Family Robinson, the ostrich race was wonderful. I mean, we had the ostrich, the elephant, the donkey. Talk about a fun day of filming, flying every which way, and I'm riding along, giggling away because I'm getting ahead of everybody, and all of a sudden the donkey stopped and I did this flip. Well, that wasn't in the script, but it wound up in the picture, and it's still there to this day.
Good boy, Lightning! Hey!
It was a glorious time.
Adventure, courage, and fun were all part of Walt Disney's entertainment philosophy, a philosophy that began and ended with family. On the wonderful world of Disney, the Robinsons were a family more American than Swiss. And as a family, they had the power to face anything together, even 600 pirates.
New Aquafresh Flex Direct has a unique pivoting head for cleaning those hard-to-reach places. Let's see how well it bends. Watch that head pivot, bending in ways the competition can't. And it's gentle on your gums, too. The new Aquafresh Flex Direct. It really uses its head.
Cameron Park, California makes Ace their place. Know why?
We make hardware.
Easy.
Make Ace your holiday place and save. Energizer batteries now 64 cents and 94 cents after a $1.30 rebate.
Ace is America's place for better ideas.
This is a square inch, and this is a wheat thin. A wheat thin is the most real food deliciousness you can get in a square inch. The most genuine toastiness. The most baked-in crunchiness. The most deep-down munchiness. The most nuttiness. The most dippiness. The most flippiness. The most snackiness. The most lip-smackiness you can get in a square inch. Wheat Thins, the most taste you can get in a square inch.
Nabisco.
Instead of making a car for the 5% of the public who can afford a $35,000 luxury sedan, we created the all-new Chevrolet Lumina for everybody. We asked thousands of people what they were looking for in a new midsize sedan. Turns out what they wanted were the comfort and features you usually find in more expensive sedans. So we built them into the new Lumina. We just didn't charge extra for them. That's what makes the new Lumina a genuine Chevrolet.
2 weeks from tonight,
welcome
on the ABC Family Movie.
Ah!
Disney presents one of its most lovable characters of all time.
Hi.
With Mickey Rooney. And an unforgettable cast.
Don't roast me.
Spend Christmas Eve with a family favorite.
You're the most wonderful dragon in the whole world.
It's a Disney classic. Peach Dragon, the ABC Family Movie, 2 weeks from tonight.
There's a cardinal rule among magicians. Never show the audience how you did it. Thankfully, Walt Disney was a magician who broke all the rules. He wanted his public to know the tricks of the trade. He liked to reveal the time and effort that went into everything the Disney Studios created. This gave rise to a series of behind-the-scenes adventures, which Disney presented on his weekly television show.
Jules Verne once said, "What one man can imagine, other men can do." And in his book, 20,000 Leagues Under the Sea, Mr. Verne himself imagined some weird and wonderful things. Now, it's often true that the imagining can be a good deal easier than the doing. And this was certainly the case when it came to making a motion picture out of Jules Verne's classic novel. How the challenge was met and the production problem solved is an adventure story all in itself.
Imagined, Disney accomplished. In Operation Undersea, Disney Studios took the public beyond the soundstage and under the waves to observe the creation of this underwater achievement. After the program won the studio its first Emmy, the public cheered and Hollywood jeered. Envious of this documentary success, other studios accused Disney of creating nothing more than an extended television commercial.
Well, it was Walt's idea, of course. We wanted to show people how much we cared about these things, the kind of fun we had, really. It wasn't just a commercial for the film, because it truly was a bit of entertainment.
Jules Verne believed our oceans could feed the entire planet, and that the sea was an untapped, unlimited source of food. Here, the farming scene was one of the most challenging to film. Scores of technicians spent over 12,000 man-hours under 6 fathoms of water. Their job? To choreograph and coordinate the movements of the performers, actors both human and aquatic. Special fish wranglers were required, and the extras weren't always cooperative.
The first Disney film that I remember was 20,000 Leagues Under the Sea. It was a type of movie that I thought was impossible to make. It topped anything that a cartoon could ever do. I mean, the giant squid alone was, I saw no wires. Who knew how they did that? That was a very, very memorable trip.
The behind the scenes shows had their impact on me, absolutely. Walt Disney was somebody I aspired to. There have been very few people historically who have ever had that kind of impact on everybody.
Action.
In the same way that we observed the making of 20,000 Leagues Under the Sea, the TV special The Secrets of Toontown took us behind the scenes for Who Framed Roger Rabbit, a film that paid tribute to the magic of Walt Disney.
Bringing Roger Rabbit's adventures to life took more than 3 years. Combining the spirit of Hollywood's past with the technical wizardry of today, this film stands as one of the greatest cinematic achievements ever attempted.
You know, I and a lot of my generation have been influenced profoundly by the films of Walt Disney, especially the films from the 30s, 40s, and right through the 50s. And I really feel that this is a movie that we're making for Walt.
Wouldn't I know?
Walt was big on wanting you to know about the technologies. And, you know, I think one of the early shows was about how you do animation.
Here at the studio, we get many letters from art students and from people who are just interested in art. Some of these letters ask questions that deserve a more detailed answer than could be given in a written reply. And so, from time to time, we're going to devote an entire program to answering a few of these questions. In our feature production of Bambi, the characters were developed by drawing from life. Our artists made thousands of action sketches, catching every pose and characteristic attitude. In the production of Lady and the Tramp, this technique of humanized animal characters reaches a point of near perfection. We first tried this approach to humanized animal animation in one of our early Silly Symphonies. For this project, we brought some kittens into the studio and let them play and roam about as they pleased, while the artist made sketches and collected ideas for the kitten story. The result of this experiment was the Academy Award winner of the year 1935, The Three Orphan Kittens.
I think that Walt had a very unique talent. Animators today keep asking us, what did you do, and what did you do with this, and how did you face this problem? And it occurs to me, well, it wasn't the procedures, it was Walt himself.
Disney animation has come a long way since Walt, and many of the studio's new techniques were revealed in a behind-the-scenes television special, The Making of the Lion King.
Here, for instance, is some hand-drawn animation of a wildebeest, and now here's a computer representation of that same motion. Here we get the sense of that motion rotating in three dimensions. We can place our camera anywhere. But one wildebeest wasn't enough. We needed hundreds of wildebeests. So we had to come up with a way that our animators could control the behavior of hundreds of beasts. So we came up with this idea of a simulation, sort of playing follow the leader. Then the next step is to match it to the background. We've built a grid. On that grid, we place one of these simulations where each of those bugs now gets replaced with a full running, galloping, hopping wildebeest.
The computer might be able to keep track of hundreds of stampeding animals, but only an artist with a pencil can create the movement and emotion that, when set to music, brings a story to life.
It's the circle of life, and it moves us all through despair and hope, through faith and love.
A lot of times when you write music for movies, you do it after the movies or the stuff's finished. But not this time. This was done as the movie evolved, we were writing. That was exciting, that was different. Music's always been important to Disney movies. I mean, from Snow White and the Seven Dwarfs to Lady and the Tramp and The Jungle Book, they all had wonderful scores. I think it's very important that people, you know, kids like to, everybody whistles those kind of songs.
The circle of life.
By bringing us behind the scenes, Disney showed us that outstanding entertainment started with outstanding people. The real Disney magic came from the studio's family of talented and dedicated craftsmen, writers, directors, animators, composers, imagineers, ordinary people doing extraordinary things. They were the ones who held the power to make our dreams come true.
By his shaver. The man who uses a bra and flex control appreciates good looks, has the flexibility to adjust to any situation, and he's not afraid to get close. But the most revealing thing about a man who uses a bra is how easy it is to spot him.
I believe this is yours.
Bra, the world's most recognized shave. The
There are millions of hungry people in this country. Fortunately, there are also millions of American Express card members. Help us raise $5 million by December 31st, because the charge against hunger is on again.
Happy holidays, Dave.
Thank you.
There sure is a lot to do during the holidays. In fact, you could really work up an appetite.
Boy, I'm hungry.
Luckily, Wendy's has a big bacon classic combo. A quarter pound of fresh beef, three strips of bacon, cheese, lots of toppings, biggie fries, and a 20-ounce drink. A delicious meal.
Here goes. I love the holidays.
Try Wendy's big bacon classic combo.
Remember to watch Wendy's three-tour challenge.
A great tournament benefiting a great cause, adoption.
What are you getting little Al for the holidays? He's growing by leaps and bounds. Remember his size this week? No? Better come into Radio Shack. We have hundreds of the gifts kids want most. And besides, with a gift from Radio Shack, there's no question. One size fits Al. Radio Shack. You've got questions, we've got answers.
Tuesday, tis the season for a house full of feudin' family members.
So great to have babies in the house again.
Yeah, there's nothing like a little projectile vomit to brighten up the holidays.
There's no place like Home Improvement for the holidays. Then Grace opens her door to the ex-in-laws.
Okay, just put down the presents, back out of the room slowly, and nobody gets hurt.
Grace Under Fire, Tuesday on ABC.
40 years of Disney television magic will continue in a moment here on ABC. 1 week from tonight, it's two wonderful holiday specials. First, travel home for the holidays with the stars. Hear Carly sing in New York. Meet the families of Kenny G and Amy Grant. And party with Aretha Franklin in Detroit.
Happy holidays!
Celebrate Christmas at home with the stars. Then, they are elegance and excellence. Now, skating's most famous pair take the ice in a very special event. Seiko presents the artistry of Torval and Dean. Right after Christmas at home with the stars, 1 week from tonight on ABC.
Want to make someone happy this holiday season? Give them a phone from Radio Shack. We have over 80 terrific phones. They'll admire the styles, appreciate features like big buttons, adore the convenience of an extra long-range cordless. And though they won't love every single call they get...
Congratulations! Act now! You've just won a free trip!
They will love the phones. Radio Shack. You've got questions, we've got answers.
New from Baskin-Robbins. And now get two quarts of delicious pre-packed ice cream for only $5.
American Eagle Service out of Chicago suspended. Details at 10.
Hmm. That feels good.
Hmm. Thanks, Mickey. You know, today's space travel is so commonplace that we almost take it for granted. But back in the mid-50s, Tomorrowland was still a dream. Starting in 1955, three Disney television programs brought the dream to life. Man in Space, Tomorrow the Moon, and Mars and Beyond. By combining the talents of gifted animators with hard scientific fact, the wonderful world of Disney sought to illuminate the fascinating world of tomorrow.
Ladies and gentlemen, here is your host, Walt Disney.
Thank you, Garko. In this exciting age when everyone seems to be talking about the future possibilities of space travel, there's much speculation on what we will discover when we visit other worlds.
In Mars and Beyond, Disney entertained an increasingly plausible notion. We are not alone in the universe.
One of the most fascinating fields of modern science. deals with the possibility of life on other planets. This is our story.
Today, there is tons of junk written about life that is supposed to be on this planet. Look at some of these titles. Oh, fantastic comics. Super horrible comics. Impossible science comics. Impossible is right. This stuff is so full of baloney. Come to think of it, I like baloney, so I think I'll take a little potluck. Oi! This one's gonna be hard to swallow. Like all the others, it starts at an ultra-secret government space project.
The hero is a young electronics genius who is always busy formulating new laws of thermodynamics and astrophysics. The heroine is his secretary, efficient, hardworking, and rather attractive. Of course, the villain is a mechanical robot from Mars. He is usually controlled by a Martian mastermind whose appearance is too horrible to reveal at this time. The escape device is a late model electrophlegmatic flying saucer. The story plot usually concerns the lack of some precious element on Mars, such as water or uranium or women. Take a letter, Miss Smith. Gentlemen, after due consideration and thorough calculation, it is my unequivocal opinion that there is absolutely no life on the planet Mars.
I think Walt Disney was ahead of his time. He was a visionary, there's no question about it. And I'm sure that there are other people out there that may not look as handsome as we do, they may not be as smart as we are, but there's got to be another civilization out there somewhere.
Speed, safety, and comfort will be the keynotes of tomorrow's highways. A multicolored highway system may enable the motorist to reach his destination by following the correct color strip. There will be miles of tubular highways, air-conditioned routes across hot desert wastelands, over sub-freezing mountain ranges, even under the oceans. As in the past, the highway will continue to play a vital role in the progress of civilization. It will be our magic carpet to new hopes, new dreams, and a better way of life for the future.
The most vibrant fantasy minds are visionaries, and those minds are what science is based on. This is not based on fact. It's based on imagining and then finding the fact that creates that imagination. I think that's another thing that is special about Walt Disney, is he was able to teach through entertainment.
At the turn of our century, man had mastered the first lessons in the art of flying. It was a humble beginning, but what amazing progress has been made since then.
Probably the very root thing in Walt was the fulfillment of your dreams. You know, in whatever way, through fairy tales, through courage and heart and perseverance, through fantasy, through hard work and science.
So once again, nature's design was tried with success. The next step was for man to try it himself.
I think he thought of himself a great deal as an educator as well as an entertainer. He was forever making the space shows. There was a Donald in Math Magic Land, and he gave you an awful lot of information with a lot of sugar coating. But it was a way that you absorbed it and you learned things.
And so, more elaborate models were tried. and this time with leg power.
Walt believed in the future. He loved scientific things, and when he'd sit in on our early story meetings, he'd hear all about it. And then he'd go to lunch, and he'd have people visiting at his table in the restaurant, and he'd hold forth on space.
In our modern world, everywhere we look, we see the influence science has upon our daily lives. Discoveries that were miracles a few short years ago are accepted as commonplace today. In this Tomorrowland series, we are combining the tools of our trade with the knowledge of the scientists to give a factual picture of the latest plans for man's newest adventure. Here's Director Ward Kimball to tell you about it.
In working with engineers and scientists, we have found that there are many different opinions as to how we will eventually cross the space frontier.
Walt was so busy down at Disneyland, bringing that to a climax, that he sort of turned over the space shows to me carte blanche. But he warned me, no science fiction. We'll call these series science factual. And that's how the Tomorrowland series were born.
During the late 1920s and early 30s, we saw an era of feverish activity among the rocket experimenters. Almost every type of vehicle was adapted to rocket power. Some fired and some backfired. These early attempts met with varying degrees of success.
A lot of people questioned our predicting what might happen. I was only quoting what I was reading in the books by astronomers.
By combining the world's best scientific and artistic minds, Man in Space, Disney's first Tomorrowland special, accomplished the impossible, an accurate picture of outer space, drawn straight from the imagination.
The total firing time has been 5 minutes. The ship will now coast for 51 minutes before the adaptation maneuver begins. At over 60 miles above the Earth, the crew members experience the sensation of weightlessness for the first time.
I would say that we're right on the button as far as the overall predictions, the mathematics, what keeps it up there, the number of miles from the Earth, the speed around the Earth. President Eisenhower happened to see Man in Space, and he told Walt he saw the show, and he says, can I borrow that film, Man in Space, for a couple of weeks, and I'll show it to some of those thick-headed generals in the Pentagon who poo-poo all that stuff.
We choose to go to the moon. We choose to go to the moon. We choose to go to the moon in this decade and do the other things, not because they are easy, but because they are hard.
Because 7 years before President Kennedy's speech, 14 years before Apollo's historic mission, Disney's Tomorrow the Moon gave 1955 a sneak preview of man's first lunar voyage.
A lot of things that were happening in those days in the late 50s and early 60s had to do with space exploration, had to do with satellites and the excitement of people going into space. We really had not thought specifically about people going into space. And that again shows the remarkable talent of the man. He was able to look ahead as Jules Verne did many, many years ago. And with that talent realized, yes, sooner or later, people would be going in space. So he really predicted before we did it exactly what we were going to be doing.
A rocket ship taking off from the Earth's surface will use almost all the fuel it can carry just to attain a speed great enough to balance the pull of gravity.
Von Braun's early rocket in the first show, the four-stage rocket, had a plane on the tip which would return to the Earth like the shuttle. So the mathematics were correct, but the hardware was a little different.
Mission completed. Man has taken his first great stride forward.
I don't think there was any question about the fact that he was a pioneer in terms of television, because the Disney presentations, you know, are still very, very popular around the world. So not only was he a visionary, but his legacy still lives on.
Within a few short years, Disney's tomorrow has become today. In film and television, his legacy represents a generation of growth, learning, and achievement. Walt's daughter once said that nothing excited her father more than history. Well, if there's anything to be learned from Disney's history, it is that by dreaming new dreams, fantasy leads to possibility.
Introducing panties that stay put, that stay in place comfortably. Now, if you could just figure out what to wear over them. Fruit of the Loom, clothes that make you feel good.
The answer, please, Mr. Crowley, today!
Think that's pressure? Try Wario's Woods, the new action puzzle where stuff's hurling down on you, in on you, and Wario is all over you. Only for Nintendo.
Table for Christmas.
I want a bunny rabbit.
A hammer.
I'm a green couch.
I want a real puppy.
When a moment matters this much, catch it on Kodak's newest film, Kodak Royal Gold. Extra sharp, extra clear for the details you'll save for a lifetime.
How are you going to come down with your chimney with your fat tummy?
Kodak Royal Gold for the holidays, for the moments that matter most.
What's the hurry? You've seen one holiday sale, you've seen them all. Okay, okay, so what makes this Payless holiday sale so special? Party shoes on sale before the party season? Tasty. You mean the good stuff's actually on sale? Boots, really? $12.99? Great price. Great idea. I agree, that's quite a sale. Yes, you were right.
Doesn't it feel good to Payless?
When this man comes down with a bad cold, he's just one step away from disaster. The last thing he needs is a cold medicine that may make him drowsy. So he takes Sudafed Cold and Cough. He knows Sudafed Cold and Cough will help clear his nasal congestion, suppress his cough, and relieve his body aches and pains without making him drowsy. When you need strong cold relief but need to stay alert, reach for Sudafed Cold and Cough. Clears you up without slowing you down.
From Steven Spielberg, a network television premiere.
I love you, Peter Pan.
Robin Williams, Julia Roberts, and Dustin Hoffman as Hook, Sunday at a special time on ABC.
Wednesday, Tamara's in love.
He's beautiful.
And it's time for some fatherly advice.
I happen to be in touch with my feminine side.
When you've had water weight gain and cramps, then we can talk about your feminine side.
An all-new Sister Sister, followed by All-American Girl, Wednesday here on ABC.
At Disneyland, all roads lead to Main Street, USA. Right, Joe?
Right.
I loved you. Disney, who spent so much time looking into the future, also believed in honoring the past. A fantasy, maybe, but this vision of turn-of-the-century America conjures the special times and traditions that children remember. Fourth of July, Valentine's Day, Christmas. Disney wanted to bring the simple joys of these occasions to life for his television audience.
There's magic everywhere tonight, in the faint sounds of carolers in the distance, or in a snow globe that can transport us to a dream filled with the magic of Disney's Christmas on Ice. This evening, the world's most highly acclaimed skaters will perform to some of the world's most beautiful music.
Disney, I would say, look at what the world hath wrought, because from him, look at what he has created.
Disney's holiday traditions live on in television specials such as Mickey's Happy Valentine.
It's Mickey's Happy Valentine Special. And now your host, Professor Ludwig Von Drake.
Welcome to the Valentine Hall of Fame, or should I say, Heart of Fame. Well, anyway, this Valentine stuff's got nothing to do with the brain, but everything to do with the heart. So let's get hopping and see how powerful this thing called love really is.
TV looks at the year 2000, one can't help but marvel at its past.
I think it's amazingly one of a kind because the original character that made it all happen is still a mouse. And the mouse is still here, and the mouse still talks, and the mouse is still just as old as he was since he piloted his, you know, that steamboat up the river there. So that really separates it from all the rest.
In the timeless world of Mickey Mouse, the sky's the limit when it comes to celebrating our national heritage. For a generation of viewers, Disney TV specials have conjured up the magic of the 4th of July.
Celebrate this spirit with Disney's all-star 4th of July spectacular. Please welcome country rock star Billy Ray Cyrus.
Tell my heart, my achy, breaky heart, I just don't think he'd understand. And if you tell my heart, my achy, breaky heart, he might blow up and kill this man.
Many of us, Disney meant family. And as we grew up, so did Disneyland. Presidents and prime ministers, Mouseketeers and movie stars have all celebrated the evolution of the happiest place on Earth. Birthdays that were captured in a series of anniversary specials.
Hi, folks. How are you today?
Hi.
Oh. You didn't happen to see Tony Danza, did you?
No.
Ever been to Disneyland before?
Oh, yes.
In fact, I have a snapshot of our first visit.
Christine Graff and Michael Schwartner. You were the first guest 35 years ago on this very spot.
My first memory of Disneyland was Tinkerbell over this castle. I loved Tinkerbell until my sister Colette told me she wasn't real. Well, Colette, check this out. For over 40 years, Disney specials have kept pace with the musical tastes of their day, embracing the worlds of pop, country, and south of the border. When Disney opened its newest park, Euro Disney, Gloria Estefan dazzled a worldwide television audience.
I wonder, wonder, wonder why I live for love and baby, 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 I live for love and live, 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 live.
At Walt Disney World's Epcot, Celine Dion brought sparkle to a 4th of July spectacular. Live, Walt Disney World's 20th anniversary special, Garth Brooks brought down the house.
But if you're gonna make a difference, if you're gonna leave your mark, you can't follow like a bunch of sheep, you gotta listen to your heart. You're busting in like old John McClane. Sometimes you got to go against the grain.
Walt Disney liked to brag about his favorite attraction here at Disneyland, the biggest attraction of all, people. In 1995, as the happiest place on Earth celebrates its 40th anniversary, the year-long festivities will commemorate the 350 million people who have visited Disneyland since it opened. Now, as ever, the parks take pride in being a place for the young, and the young at heart.
I love it here.
Yeah, it's beautiful.
It's perfect.
Absolutely. I can't think of a thing to complain about. Mm,
it's pretty.
Pleasant.
Neat.
Clean.
I hate it when there's nothing to complain about.
This is terrible.
Yeah, why did we come to this miserable place?
Boo!
This!
Close this dump down!
Taxi!
This year, Disney celebrates 40 years of magic on television by looking forward to many more with Mickey Mouse and all his friends.
Soon.
Have a joyous holiday with Red Door, the sophisticated fragrance from Elizabeth Arden. Now, enjoy a special collection of travel-size Red Door treasures, just $40 at the Elizabeth Arden counter.
Step right up to the Fisher-Price Little People Fun Park. Round and round and round the fun goes. Where it stops, nobody knows. The Little People Fun Park from Fisher-Price.
It's the extra little details that make the holidays even more special. Pearls sewn on by hand, the sparkle of yarn, arranging things just right, the feel of velvet, dressing up and curling up. That's what I love about the holidays. And that's what you'll love about my collection. Special for another reason. It's a Kmart Extra, a value you won't find anywhere else.
Most manufacturers show their four-wheel drives in places where, quite honestly, you'll never go.
Billy! Billy!
But for exceptional comfort and control on your next adventure, you need the driver control system found only on the new Chevy Blazer. The all-new Chevy Blazer. It's nice to know it's there.
First thing you gotta remember about Disney World is to pace yourself. If you try to do it all at once, you'll be sleeping like a baby by lunchtime. Number two, don't eat right before you go on Mr. Toad's wild ride. Number three, Goofy is huge. Goofy could beat up Dad. I guess that's it. Ugh.
You're gonna love this place, Larry. It really brings out the kid in you.
Call 1-407-W-DISNEY and make the dream come true.
We'll be leaving in about 3 weeks.
It's back-to-back coach. Hayden gets an offer from the pros.
You're a genius.
I'm an agent.
Don't put yourself down.
And wait till he tells his wife.
Wake up.
Not now, Hayden. Later, I promise.
Plus, find out what Hollywood star shows up on an all-new coach. Then.
Are you ready for some football?
It's do or die time for the Kansas City Chiefs and the Miami Dolphins on Monday Night Football.
Walt Disney was fond of saying, it all began with a mouse. But the end is nowhere in sight. For over 40 years, Disney Television has brought into our homes the inspiration to dream and the will to believe our dreams are worthwhile. Today, Walt Disney's dream continues beyond his lifetime into the future as he would have wanted it. He once said, I'm not Disney anymore. I used to be Disney, but now Disney is something in the public mind. It stands for something, and you don't have to explain what it is.
Well, if there was ever a right time to say, and they lived happily ever after, this must be it.
Lois and Clark's not on tomorrow. But coming up next, Superman tries to save the world. When he loses his memory...
You're Superman.
That's crazy.
Will Metropolis be destroyed?
The sky literally is falling.
It's a Super Saturday with Lois and Clark, coming up next on ABC.
Good evening, America. I'm Joan London. Next week, it's Good Morning America's Great Gift Guide. Also, Jack Hanna's Reindeer, Julia Child's Holiday Cookbooks, and a survival kit for spending the holidays with your family. Plus, Michael J. Fox, Bonnie Raitt, and Michael Keaton next week on Good Morning America.